Okay. We will continue to have JavaScript examples throughout the semester. We're not done with JavaScript completely, but our focus is going to shift probably next week to server-side code. All right, if you remember, way back in the beginning of class, we talked about client-side code, server-side code, and then merging them together in a certain way, being AJAX code. What I want to do today is I want to wrap up and possibly do a few JavaScript examples, possibly talk about the quiz, which should be available tomorrow, I would think. You'll have plenty of time to complete it when I assign it. And to talk a little bit about jQuery, all right? And my aim will be to start introducing some jQuery stuff in to the class as we progress, all right, and as we go on. So first things first, all right, let's look at what the quiz will consist of. It'll be online. I may even get it done today if I can stay vertical a good part of the day. We have a study guide for the JavaScript quiz. Do keep in mind that some of these relate to older stuff that I don't really talk about too much anymore. The midterm will consist of short answer questions. In other words, there's not going to be any multiple choice or true or false or whatever. If you are required to write code, it'll be very focused code. In other words, you won't be asked to write a complete web page that does something. You'll be asked to write in the instructions to do this or the instructions to do that. So you'll write little code snippets, not entire pieces of code. I may give you, for example, an HTML page and say, what would you need to change to it to make it call a validation function? What would you need to put within that validation function to do one thing if the text box had a value of 10 in it, to do something else if it had a value of 20 in it? Those sorts of things. All right. XHTML, what is it? Difference from HTML? Don't worry about that. Client-server, what sort of functionality is implemented on the client side and what is on the server side? Each of these two validations, or not validations, but each of these two scripting platforms have their own distinct strengths and weaknesses. And as we see when we put together, at the end of the semester, some AJAX stuff, essentially what we're doing is we're exploiting the strengths of the two tools together. All right? But right now we're simply focusing on the client side. Separating presentation from content. What does that mean? Having the CSS file separate, and a little bit beyond that, well, you could also have separate JavaScript, but a little bit beyond just separating the files, not putting anything in the HTML file that does anything with the appearance. For example, back in the old days, people used font tags all the time. All right, that was an example of the content of the page, the HTML page, also changing the appearance of the page. Or people would use break tags. whereas you probably want to use a margin tag or a margin CSS rule or something like that. So the better that we can separate those things, the better off we're going to be. Client-side triangle simply is the interplay between JavaScript, CSS, and HTML. Object-oriented programming. Objects, properties, and methods, the DOM examples we went over, and functions, arguments, and return values. HTML events, and then finally, some of the focuses of the stuff that we've done in JavaScript. Declaring variables, alerts, what weakly type means, loops, if, scope of variables, equal versus two equals. How to refer to form fields, creating functions, and so on down the line.
Is this quiz considered our midterm?
Yeah, I think at one point I call it a midterm, at one point I call it a quiz, but yeah, there's a quiz on JavaScript, there's a quiz on PHP, and then there's a the final exam, which covers everything, but the focus will be on AJAX. Questions over any of this?
How long is it, like, question lines?
About 10. 10 questions, give or take. All right. Let's talk about jQuery now for a minute, because we can go over jQuery and we can talk about what it means. And we can talk about how it's used, and we can see an example of it, and sort of set you up for doing more examples of this in the upcoming week. Is anyone familiar with what jQuery is?
JavaScript's cousin.
JavaScript's cousin. All right, mom or dad's side?
I don't know
either. Yeah, I haven't seen the family tree. No, not really.
Okay, wait, what are the three subjects in here? Ajax?
JavaScript, and PHP.
Is PHP the last one we're going to do?
No, Ajax is the last one we're going to do. Yeah. Ajax is sort of the merger between JavaScript and PHP.
Okay, that's what
it's the usage of those, yeah.
When I was looking up JavaScript scripts to use, like,
okay.
That's what I learned from the internet.
Okay, that's what you learned from the internet. That and of course it's true, right? Because it was on the internet. So jQuery is better, so use that instead of JavaScript. Well, we can talk, once we define what jQuery is a little bit, we can talk about why someone would say that and whether it's accurate or not. All right? As with most things, you know, there's probably an element of truth to it, but let's understand it in more detail. Dave, how would you define jQuery?
Almost like its own style sheet of sorts.
Its own style sheet? You are correct in that, especially when you talk about, all right, to extend the family tree metaphor, jQuery has maybe a sibling or a cousin or something called jQuery Mobile, which allows you to create web pages that look like mobile apps. And that is big into the styling of it. All right. So I could see, I know you've had the mobile web development class, so I could see why you would have that perspective about it being styling. All right. And it's not to say that it's inaccurate, but there's more to it than that. Okay. What it is it's a JavaScript framework. All right. Pardon me?
Like C# has a framework?
Yeah, more or less. All right. And jQuery is written in JavaScript. So jQuery, if you will, is an extension of JavaScript, a framework. Now, when you think of a framework, you think of a couple things. You think of giving you a starting point so that you can build on it. All right? All the JavaScript instructions and all the JavaScript functions we did in this class, we wrote ourselves from ground zero up. All right? Now, that takes a lot of effort. All right? If you're going to go and write your own code all the time. I should have a light show going on or something, because I realized this video, the way that I was sitting was a blank white wall for the first 15 minutes, all right, with me off to the side talking. So we were writing everything on our own from scratch. Now, there's something good about that, and there's something bad about that. The something good about that is if we write something from scratch, we can control every single aspect of it, all right? The downside is that's a lot of work to do, you know. It would be like the difference between baking a cake based on a mix or baking a cake completely from scratch, right? If you do a good job, and if you're a great baker, you could probably bake a cake better from scratch than you could using a box, using a cake framework, all right? But for most of us, we might be better off just using a framework because they've already done a lot of the work for us and we just need to sort of fill in. And do we want it to be round or square? Do we want it to be so on? You know. The other thing is that we can sort of mix and match, right? We could, for example, bake the cake from scratch and use canned icing to finish it off. Or the other way around. We could make our own icing if we know that we do a great job at icing and use a box cake. So the idea of jQuery is that it gives us a starting point. It's a framework. It itself is written in JavaScript and it extends JavaScript. And what it's meant for is typically when you have these software frameworks, what they do is they take something that is very common, something that a lot of people do, and it makes it easier to do those things. All right? Those of you that have done .NET, all right, ASP.NET, you know that there are validation controls in ASP.NET. All right? Why are there validation controls? Because everyone has to validate forms in ASP.NET. Every web developer that develops a form needs to have validation for it. So in ASP.NET, that particular framework has controls built in to do that sort of validation. So that part is canned. And it is nice to have that because you can write your own validation, that's true, but it's nice if someone else picks up some of the load of work for you, right? That can save you and that can allow you to focus on the stuff that you have to work on, all right? There's other advantages too. There's a good chance that the validation controls in ASP.NET have been really tested well. Probably better, more thorough, extensive testing than you will ever test your code. And therefore, there's less likely to be bugs. You're going to handle things in a consistent way, and so on. The idea of jQuery is the same thing. All right? The idea of jQuery is that we're going to take and we're going to put in a jQuery framework. And with that framework, we're going to make it easier to do certain common functions. So to answer your question or to respond to the statement you made, don't use JavaScript, use jQuery. jQuery will do a lot of the work for you for common sorts of things, and then as a result, it can put you in a good position. Now, here's where the catch is jQuery is JavaScript, and jQuery is simply an extension of JavaScript. And to really understand jQuery, it's good, it's important for you to understand JavaScript as well. All right, jQuery simply provides you some shortcuts to do some things quickly that you might want to do. So we're going to look at a particular example on jQuery. We'll look at one of them, and then depending on our time, we might look at another, or we might look at just a JavaScript example. I was actually thinking that when I was talking about, that does seem to be a consistent theme. Because I'm always thinking about my next meal and what I'm going to have. So that's probably how. I'll post this link to Angel. And there's a list of jQuery tutorials. Let's hit refresh. And here's a basic form, basic jQuery validation form demo. All right, we have a form where we enter in the first name, last name, email, and password, and then they have a button. Now, to Dave's point of styling, some of the styling is probably done via jQuery as well. But that is a good question. I would suspect that's done via CSS. So, pardon me? Yeah. That it is not necessarily cross-browser compatible. But yeah, you can do gradients with CSS. All right, let's go and let's click the button without entering anything in. And sure enough, we get, please enter your first name, please enter your last name, please enter a valid email address, please provide a password. We type something in here. Notice one thing, as soon as I start typing in something, the error message goes away. That's a nice little feature as well. All right. Now, let's look at the code for this page. Actually, I downloaded the code a minute ago. So let's look at this. All right, here's a bunch of styles. Done with that? Yeah, I guess they did use an image. The style part we're not really interested in. We are interested in this, especially the first one and the last one. This is putting into our code the jQuery library. And you can download the jQuery library for free and use it and include it. But you have to include it. You have to tell it to include it in your page, and that will give you access to that functionality. One second, please. All right. So we have to include that in there to point to it, to say that we want to use this. So we have these libraries. All right. Once we've defined these libraries, here's how we define the validation. We define a set of rules. Alright, and we define it according to this specific syntax. First name, colon, required. Means that you have to have a first name in there. Last name, required. Email is required, and it must be a valid email address. So that's nifty. So if I put in something that's not a valid email address, I still get the error. Then it's valid. Password has to be 5 characters, I think, according to this. And sure enough, once we do that. So if we look at what we're doing here, we're describing, we're not writing the code, we're simply describing the rules that we want to have applied to this form's validation. And then we give the messages that we want to have displayed. Please enter your first name, please enter your last name. Either please provide a password or your password must be at least 5 characters long, and so on. Now, is this easier than writing your own JavaScript code? I don't know, all right? The syntax looks a little confusing, but the nice thing is this looks like something that I could sort of take, copy, paste, and tweak it, and maybe look up some other parameters, and not have to work the details of all the JavaScript. All right? So when we define this, we're setting up the JavaScript sort of behind the scenes to go in and do the validation that we previously hand-coded. Alright? So, that's an example of a jQuery form validation and how you could use it. A good exercise would be to take one of your forms and try applying this to it and see. Maybe that'll be a requirement of a PHP assignment, your first PHP assignment now that I think about it. Let's look at other tutorials from here or other demos. Here's another example. We put our mouse over it. And it swaps the image. We pull our mouse off of it, and it swaps it back to the other one. Here is a jQuery function that allows that. Couple lines of code.
Does the .img swap contain the actual name of both of those images?
The img swap relates to the image, not both images, but this relates to a class of image. So we assign the CSS class of image swap to this image tag. there's the code for this. And as we put our mouse over menu item 2, menu item 3, 4, right, if we look at the page source here, again, we see a lot of styling. We see that it includes the jQuery framework. And we see a relatively small number of instructions that get that to work. Where we go in and we set properties based on the mouse over and the mouse out to go in and make the submenu either visible or hidden. So what I intend to do over the second portion of the course is to talk about PHP and server-side scripting. And as we're doing this, to introduce some more client-side scripting stuff. And some of it will be in the form of JavaScript examples, because I think it's important for you to understand that fundamentally. But some of it will also be in jQuery examples. All right, so we'll bounce between them. But I did want to define our terms and make sure we understand what jQuery is. All right, let's put up my famous diagram again. And as a review, we stated that client makes a request through the internet, makes it to the web server, that responds back with a package of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. We talked about the roles of each of these things, HTML being the content, CSS being the appearance, JavaScript being the behavior or the interactivity. And we see the strength of JavaScript is it gets loaded along with the page. So it gets sent back with the HTML page. And that's true whether it's jQuery or JavaScript. Because again, remember, jQuery is simply JavaScript. All right? Or is built on top of JavaScript is probably a better way to put it. So the advantages, the wins that you get by doing stuff client-side scripting-wise is the immediacy of it. You have already the HTML page and CSS. You have delivered the JavaScript. Therefore, any of the interactivity can happen like that. All right? So for mouse over menus, for validation, for all those things, they can happen immediately because the client, the browser, has everything it needs to do it. JavaScript, then, on the client, the job of it is to manipulate pages that have been delivered to the browser without having to re-request them from the server. So we're talking about making changes in appearance, maybe some changes in content, but we're talking about making changes to an existing page that's already been delivered, without having to go back and re-requesting it from the web server.
the web server, and this is true for all server-side scripting, whether you talk about ASP.NET or PHP, Ruby on Rails, its job is to dynamically create the page. And when we say dynamically, we mean that it changes. The page that gets delivered changes depending on who, when, other details about the client making the request. So you and I both go to Angel Login. Our home pages are the same page, but they look very different for me than for you. Why? Because the web server created that page when you requested it. All right? It went through and it looked up, based on your user ID and password, what classes you're enrolled in, and all the other properties that you set, and it prepared a web page just for you. When I log in, the same thing. So some of the data is going to come from the form data. So user ID and password. Some is going to be looked up in a database. In other words, it's going to be a database somewhere that contains a list of what classes each person is dealt with. And all these come together, and the server churns on this and processes the script, and the script's output is a web page that contains HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So these server-side scriptings dynamically create the page, and they create the page that will be different depending on any number of circumstances. Another good example, to use another food analogy, is if you do a Google search for restaurants. If I do a Google search for Italian restaurants, I will get Italian restaurants in the Elyria area. All right? If someone else does that, my brother in New York does a search there, he's going to get restaurants in the New York area. All right? Why? Well, because the results could be customized. The Google algorithm knows what's most relevant for a particular user based on a number of different criteria. All right? Comes over as part of the request that the client makes. So it can use that information and gear the results to that. So, what does that mean? That means that we can no longer simply open our pages in the browser. All right? When we're doing this stuff, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, we can open up the pages in a browser simply by double-clicking on them. All right? Sure, why not? That browsers understand HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So we can just double-click on them, and we can see how the page looks like. If we double-clicked on, say, a PHP script, the PHP script is not going to be a completed web page. The PHP script is simply a recipe, instructions to create a web page. And so if we tried to open that up directly in the browser, we're not going to get a completed web page. We instead have to ask a web server to deliver us a PHP page created from that script. Let me check to see if PHP is installed on this machine. I sure hope it is. every semester. Every semester we get this error. Drives me crazy. All right, I'll make sure it's fixed for next time. Well, we won't be able to demonstrate that today, but we will next Monday. Now, what does a PHP page look like? All right. What's the difference between a PHP page and a regular HTML page? Well, PHP pages have the PHP extension, so we're no longer going to create .html, we're going to create .php files. And the PHP files themselves are nothing more than a mix of plain old HTML, CSS, and JavaScript and special PHP code. So, here's an example of a very simple PHP page. Simply says hello world. All right. Now we could have just written this in HTML, right? But what's the fun in that? We want to learn PHP. Notice that a good part of this page is plain old HTML. But notice here we have this tag and this tag. Not really tags, but declarations. This tells the browser, or I'm sorry, the server, not the browser, that we are not in HTML land, we are in PHP land. Therefore, the server needs to execute the code between here and here. All right? So here's what, in a nutshell, the server does with a PHP file. If it's plain HTML code, it simply delivers it as is to the server. So, server's reading this file, HTML, get sent to the server. Get sent to the client. Head, sent to the client. Title, sent to the client. Head. It hits this, and it knows, based on that declaration, that this is not HTML code. This is PHP code, which is to be executed. All right? So PHP will then process this, and the results of the processing will get, in this case, echoed or printed to the client. So when you see in these PHP examples echo or print, that means send the result to the client. And then we're back in HTML mode, and that's the rest that you will see. So in other words, if I were to run this through my web browser, through my web server, and look at it on the browser, this is what gets delivered to the client. HTML is verbatim, except for this statement, which is going to echo or print out or send to the client that line. Exactly. All right. The difference between writing PHP and writing HTML is when you write HTML, you're writing the finished product. When you're writing PHP, you are writing the instructions for the web server to write the web page. And again, typically what you're going to see is you're going to see a mix of that, because some of the HTML doesn't change from page to page, whereas some of the HTML does change from page to page and is done dynamically. If, for example, we are to look at Amazon, and again, I don't know what Amazon uses, what programming language Amazon uses, but if we look up products and we go and look at different product pages, notice how this page, this stuff on the top is going to be identical to if I go to this page or this page. All that stuff's identical. What's different? This center section is different. So what they likely have is a server-side code, that part of the web page is plain old HTML. And part of it, this data gets pulled from the database for the specific product that you're looking at. So it sort of fills in the gaps of the page that's being generated. Now, and that's exactly what we have here. Of course, here, you know, all of this page is plain old HTML. And here, that gap that gets filled in is simply with another little snippet of HTML. But we could have processing in here to look at the time, for example. And if it's before noon, say good morning. If it's afternoon, say good afternoon.
What does echo do?
Echo says print or send to the client.
Oh, okay.
All right. All right, here's a good example. Where we have PHP line, and the previous page was not really much better than just plain old HTML, because it just said hello world over and over again. In this case, this code looks at and displays echoes or displays or prints to the client server HTTP user agent, which is the browser that the user is using. So this will be different if you ran this code on one machine versus another. It would give you a different message based on that. wanted to overview, give an overview of PHP and server-side scripting. It really is simply a mix of HTML and code that outputs HTML. And you get to write both. You get to write this, the plain HTML parts and the code that generates that. I would hope by Monday that we have the issue straightened out here and I'm able to demonstrate better PHP stuff. Questions?
I don't know if this is something you want to say until Monday or whatnot. I know in the past, when I've downloaded WAMP, it was almost preferable to go with the 32-bit version. I had an issue once with a 64-bit version. That's why I had to reinstall it. I don't know if that's something you can kick around or comment on later or whatnot. It just seemed to be something that kind of caught my attention in the past.
Well, that might, that, you know, that would be something that would be distinct to your particular setup. So we'll talk about what you need to do to run PHP, because you need a web server software installed and you need PHP installed. So we'll talk about that and how you can get that on Monday.